Good evening. My name is Hortense Crozier-Perfect, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and divine revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. We hold classes in the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in any good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, or Latin languages have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in our English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus or Jehovah are impossible rendering of the true and original name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, the limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being that is having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood and divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title can be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai, and he showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims of the Institute are as follows. First, to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, to extirpate the current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua Messiah. And 10th, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We will now have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas, a selection of music, and our scripture lesson will be Psalms 105 by Dr. Eunice Ryford.
And give the prayer. Almighty Yahweh, we know you are everywhere. You know the future and you know the past, of course. And there is nothing hide on you. You know our thinking and the future. We are made in the likeness of you. We are aware of that. We can see you everywhere. You are everywhere. And keep us, feeding us, because we are very happy receiving those instructions of you. And the more we learn, the more happy we are, of course. And I say, keep feeding us, we need it. Because there is so much to learn, but we learn in a small page. We are not that intelligent, but you are not intelligent. You are intelligence himself. Thank you so much. I say all those things in your only son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
Don't Good evening, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from Psalms 105, division, page 736. And I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainer, Scripture Research Association Incorporated. Psalms 105, division, page 736. O give thanks unto Yahweh, proclaim his name, make known his deeds among the people. Sing unto him, sing psalms unto him, talk ye of all his wondrous works. Glory ye in his holy name, let the heart of them rejoice that seek Yahweh. Seek Yahweh and his strength, seek his face evermore. Remember his marvelous works that he has done, his wonders and the judgment of his mouth. O ye seed of Abraham, his servant, ye children of Jacob, his chosen. He is Yahweh our Elohim, his judgments are in all the earth. He has remembered his covenant forever, the word which he commanded to the thousands generations, which covenant he made with Abraham and his oath unto Isaac, and confirmed the same unto Jacob for a law and to Israel for an everlasting covenant, saying, unto thee will I give the land of Canaan, the lot of your inheritance. When they were but a few men in number, yea, very few, and strangers in it. And they went from one nation to another, from one kingdom to another people. He suffered no man to do them wrong. Yea, he proved kings for their sakes, saying, touch not my anointed, and do my prophet no harm. Moreover, he called for a famine upon the land. He brake the whole staff of bread. He sent a man before them, even Joseph, who was sold for a servant, whose feet they hurt with feather. He was laid in iron. Until the time that his word came to pass, Yahweh tried him. The king sent and loosed him, even the rulers of the people, and let him go free. He made him master of his house and ruler of all his substance, to bind his princes at his pleasure and teach his senators wisdom. Israel also came into Egypt, and Jacob sojourned in the land of Ham. And he increased his people greatly and made them stronger than their enemies. He turned their hearts to hate his people, to deal subtly with his servants. He sent Moses, his servant, and Aaron, whom he had chosen. They showed his signs among them and wonders in the land of Ham. He sent darkness and made it dark, and they rebelled not against his word. He turned their waters into blood and slew their fish. Their land brought forth frogs in abundance in the chambers of their kings. He spake, and there came divers sorts of flies and lice in all their coasts. He gave them hail for rain and flaming fire in their land. He smote their vines also and their fig trees and brake the trees of their coasts. He spake, and the locust came, and the caterpillars, and that without number, and did eat up all the herbs in their land, and devoured the fruit of their ground. He smote also all the firstborn in their land, the chief of all their strength. He brought them forth also with silver and gold, and there was not one feeble person among their tribes. Egypt was glad when they departed, for the fear of them fell upon them. He spread a cloud for a covering and fire to give light in the night. The people asked, and he brought quail and satisfied them with bread of heaven. He opened the rock, and the water gushed out. They ran in the dry places like a river. For he remembered his holy promise and Abraham his servant. And he brought forth his people with joy and his chosen with gladness, and gave them the land of the heathens, and they inherit the labor of the people, that they might observe his statutes and keep his law. Hallelujah. I have read Psalms 150 vision. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Samuel Salas and Dr. Eunice Reiser. And now for our first speaker, we will call the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marlon Love.
Tonight will be testimony night or lecture, whichever one prefer. Anybody would like to, even on Zoom and those that are here, if you want a testimony, you're welcome to get up.
I have something I would like to say.
Hallelujah.
It'll only be a minute. I want to thank Yahshua for allowing me to attend class and to learn something of his purpose and plan. I was listening to the Springfield class this evening.
Me too.
And one of the deans were going over the, as I want to call it, the Moses, the Elohim chart where Moses is going up into the mount. I said before that I've been in this gospel since 1976. And you learn something every time you attend class or listen to a lecture. Now, listening to this lecture this evening, the gentleman was talking about Yahweh in the cloud and that he's pure spirit. Now, every time I listen to this and I see it, I just understood that when the moderator says that Yahweh is not a cloud, but he chose a cloud, and everything abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Everything is within this cloud, and nothing escapes it. Looking at this chart, you see darkness down in Egypt, but it's all within the cloud. So it just came to me that everything is within the cloud. Everything is within Yahweh. Nothing escapes Yahweh. We're within the cloud. Everything that happens, it happens because Yahweh purposed it to happen. And it just amazed me that all these years, I've been seeing this chart and seeing this cloud and everything encompassed in it, that's the way it is. There's nothing outside of Yahweh, nothing. And everything that happens, Yahweh causes it to happen. So we are truly blessed to be in this gospel that Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley gave us these charts so we could see him, see the operation, see everything that is going on and have an understanding that nothing is happening without Yahweh causing it to happen. We're caught up in time and we're seeing it play out. Because when Yahweh spoke it from the beginning, it was, it is, and it will be. And that just, it just blew my mind away that I've been seeing this for years. And I just understood that everything is within Yahweh and nothing is outside of him. And with that, I want to say, hallelujah.
Anyone else would like to have anything to say? Testimony, lecture?
I could give a testimony.
Mr. Sean.
Good evening, class. Well, it's a privilege to be able to address the body of Yahshua the Messiah and speak of anything that, you know, I've come to know and see and understand since coming down here to this teaching. And, you know, I appreciate the remarks from the previous speaker. And I got a testimony that's a little similar in the sense that, you know, I'm just grateful that we have a place to go to learn what thus saith Yahweh. And there's not somebody who's trying to tell us we got to believe it a certain way. One of the things that I appreciated from, you know, the way that the founder of the school, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, kind of had things set up is he told the students that came down to these schools not to believe what he said just because he said it, but to make him prove it until you're satisfied. And there was a time where I was into modeling and acting and whatnot. There was all of these scouts that would come around and they would try to get me to pay to be on their talent team or whatever, recruit me, but they wanted me to pay. And I just didn't think I thought there was something wrong with that. And I you know, didn't really get down with that too much. And then I got introduced to a recruiter who wanted me, and they're like, we'll pay you to come and do this for us. We don't want you to pay us to get in line for people to see you. We know, we're confident that the people are going to like you and you're the look that we're looking for, so we're paying you. And then there's a lot of those agencies like that. They're kind of scam artists because they feed off of the people's aspirations to succeed. Everybody wants to be Hollywood, you know, or a lot of people that. And I wasn't too big into it in the first place, but people told me I should, and I seemed pretty natural at doing it. But I just wasn't going to pay somebody all of my money I worked hard for to have the ability to do it, until I found a recruiter that actually was going to pay me. When I got in the door and I started talking to those people, they're like, yeah, they told me the lowdown. All of those people that are pay to play, yeah, there's some success that comes out of there. There's some people who make it out of there, but they're in the wrong place. It's just a meat factory, and that's how they generate their money, is through the subscriptions of the clients that they have on their talent list. And that's the truth, whether you want to accept it or not, in that kind of industry. And what I'm talking about that is because it relates to me when I came into this school coming out of Christendom. And I remember going to the church, and, you know, they have a structure to it. You know, it opens up and they have the choir with some music playing and they set the mood, and people are coming in, you find your seats, you talk to some people, you know, and there's just a certain structure to how those sermons are set up, and they expect you to behave the same way every time you come into one of those functions. And that was all right for me because that's what everybody else was doing, but I just wasn't getting satisfied with what was being told. And there was a lot of rhetoric, but it didn't mean anything to me. It was gobbledygook, if you will. We're having some technical difficulties here. Anyhow, as long as you hear me, I'll continue. We can figure out what's going on with that. And when I would go to the pastor, preacher, whatever you want to call him, and ask them a question, it would be a lot of, I can't answer that question for you. That's something God's going to, you know, like that's God's business, something like that. There was never really anything behind what they had to say, but a good feeling and, you know, pray on it. That's all. That was the go-to. You pray on it. You pray hard enough and God will make a way for you to, you know, get your rent paid, whatever the question it was. It wasn't always about monetary things. I wouldn't ask the preacher about anything monetary. I was just kind of being funny there. I would ask about how to save my soul and how to know that my soul has been saved. And, you know, I get the rundown of praying, coming to church, being involved in the church, getting water baptized, and devoting my time to the church and preaching the gospel and praising God and not sinning, turning away from sin, and, you know, trying the best I can to be a good boy. And as soon as I hit the streets, I want to be the biggest and baddest thug there was out there, because, you know, if I tried to be a good guy, people would run you over like a tire over concrete or asphalt. If you just get ran over like it's the thing to do. You know how many times tires roll over the asphalt going down the road? That's where they're supposed to be. And that's what it felt like out in the world, trying to be a good person without any kind of knowledge and understanding of this teaching. Are we okay? Are we still on? Okay. And that's what makes me so thankful to have a place like this to come to, where you can learn in actuality something about Yahweh and his purpose according to his pattern, and to know that he has a pattern that you can use to prove his purpose and understand his plan. It's a beautiful thing. We have to have these charts and this textbook and to be able to correlate those things. And all of the audio recordings that are out there of lectures of the founder, to be able to study and check for discrepancies. And you won't find any if you pay attention to what's said. You can't do nothing with this teaching. You can't refute it. Now, you can go on ahead and say, oh, you're wrong and it didn't happen, but you can't show any evidence that there is a fact, in fact, proof that this teaching is incorrect. And that makes me happy. That gives me peace during those times when the world feels like it's coming down on me. And I'm not going to even front. When the world is coming down on you, it's hard to remain conscious of the ever-presence of Yahweh. And that's the adversary doing his job right there. Because he is there to offer up confusion into your conscious, so that you stop thinking about that ever presence of Yahweh in your life, in you, Because when you're going through a situation and you remain conscious of Yahweh's pattern and you looking for the principles of intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength in whatever it is that you're dealing with, you have peace, because it's not going to be too long before you figure out what's going on. That's a fact, Jack, if Yahweh reveals it to you, though. I was so glad to hear Dr. I can't pronounce it as good as Nanette does, his last name, Dr. Bernie Villanueva. I can't say it right. I apologize, Bernie. But I was so glad to hear his introductory lecture and how he went through things. And it was great to see him come and visit. And I reached out to Dr. Love, and I was talking to him about that. And then I reached out to him himself, to Bernie himself. And we had a really good talk. And one of the things that came up during our talk is the statement that the founder has made in the archetype of, in order for you to be able to realize, actualize, I'm paraphrasing, if you will, but to be able to have a benefit out of this teaching, as him and comparatively few others have, is solely based on your ability to accept, you know, the truth, like scientifically proven facts and scripturally attested truths, right? Not just what pop culture wants to call my truth, because now a lot of people got this whole bandwagon thing and like, my truth is, you know, that I don't like you, and that's good enough. And then, you know, if that person may take the time to get to know that other person that they don't like a little bit more, maybe that truth would change. Yeah, it's true that you don't like me at this time, but that can change, because that's an opinion. And that's corruptible, and that can change. I could save your cat. You didn't like me, and then now I saved your cat. I'm your best friend. You know, now you like me, type of thing like that. But we're talking about having the ability to accept scriptural truths, what was written, how it was originally written in the Hebrew text. What we use in the school is the Holy Name Bible. And we'll tell you that all of the Bibles have grammatical errors. They have erroneous substitutions. They have misinterpolations and mistranslations. And not one of them is 100% written correctly. Not your Holy Name Bible, not your King James Version Bible, not your Dewey, not nothing, none, not your Vulgate, none of them. They all got something wrong with them. But what you can do when you have this pattern is you can see, when you understand this pattern, the pattern of the tabernacle, you can see how an account plays out according to a death, burial, and a resurrection. You're going to see a 40 principle in there. You'll see a 50 principle in there. You'll see a 60 principle in there. You'll see 70, which is perfection. You'll see all of those steps, the seven steps throughout these accounts. They'll be threefold. And you can know when something says, let's talk about a baptism. You got different ages. And in that age, if we can get the ages and dispensations, I don't know if that's going to work right now because the computer's not doing too well. On the ages and dispensations chart, thank you. On the ages and dispensations chart, you have that third age, which is the post-diluvian age. And in that age, you were under the that Mosaic law. And that Mosaic law was a law of carnal or physical ordinances. And when Yahshua came in and walked the earth plane for his 33 and a half years, he spent that time in his ministry fulfilling that law. Everything that Yahshua did was in a fulfillment of that law, so that that law could be taken out of the way, that physical law, it could be completed, because that law, if it could be completed, it would be unto their righteousness. But they didn't have anyone that could do that law, so they were stuck doing it for thousands of years until Yahshua came on the scene and fulfilled it. And those people had got stuck in setting their ways and used to the tradition. They had been doing it so long. A whole bunch of them just didn't want to go along with and recognize Yahshua for what he was doing as he fulfilled that law. And upon his death, he ushered in a new covenant. Can I have, what is that? I will write a new covenant, Jeremiah 31, 31, please. Is that what it is? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Read. No, you got. You can continue reading. Now, pay attention. This is the new covenant that's going to be. We had that. I just got done explaining what that old covenant was about. That old testament, that old book of the Bible, which you got in your book. If your book contains all of the books from Genesis to Malachi, we got that old book, that old covenant written about in there. Now we got a new covenant, and specifically, just to narrow it down, that old covenant was written in that first five books of the law. That was written, that's where you can find that law, that old covenant. All the information that you need to know about that law is written in Genesis through Deuteronomy. And everything that you have from Joshua down to Malachi is a witness to it. These are the prophets. So you got the law, which is the first five books of the Bible, and then you got the prophets, which are the remaining. I forget the number from time to time. Sometimes I get it, but I'm not hitting today for that. But you got the law, and then you got the prophets. Now here in Jeremiah 31, where we're reading in the prophets, and he's saying right here what this new covenant that will be, that has not come at the time that this was scribed out, but it was on its way. Read. Now he will put his law in our inward parts and write it in our hearts. Now you can go back over to that Moses chart. You can see that in the middle, in the wilderness of Sinai, there is a tabernacle pitched out there, and there's tribes of people and certain other migratory charts. It'll show all of the different camps all surrounding that. But for the artist rendition of this, you just got those camps on the one side representing the camp. But there were camps on all four sides of that tabernacle out there in the wilderness. And there were tribes in each one of them camps, and 12 tribes. Here's a better picture that shows more accurately what it might look like out there in that wilderness. Now, the reason why I'm bringing that up and I'm talking about that, because these are instruments that everything that you're looking at around that tabernacle with them tribes and how they're set, the side of that tabernacle that they're on, the direction that tabernacle is facing, everything about that was specifically according to the law that was given. That those were physical things that had to be done in order to attain to their righteousness. And there were 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances, 603 more than the Ten Commandments that they teach you about mainly in Christendom. They'll tell you about tithing too. So that's not one of the Ten Commandments. Is tithing in the Ten? I don't think so. No, I mean, but if I'm wrong, you can correct me. But anyhow, they put the tithing. If it's not in the Ten, they make that close 11. They need that money. All right, I digress from that. There is a physical law that was given to them. The circumcision. See, these laws were for the Jews and the Jews only. And so being a Gentile, which I am, I'm not a Hebrew out of the lineage, any one of them 12 tribes, there is no requirement for me as a physical person to be circumcised. There's no requirement for me to be baptized. There's no requirement for me to take this Passover and recognize that Passover. There's no requirement for any of those 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances for me. That was a law for the Jews and for the Jews only. And you can read that specifically in the law, that it was for them and it wasn't for anyone else. And if anybody was to be in their household, they had to be adopted in to recognize these things. There was a process of adoption that they had to go through, be a servant or a stranger of any matter to be in that household. There was certain ritual that needed to be accomplished in order for them to be accepted in doing any of these things. And then they say, you come in and you're 30 years old, you got to get circumcised. 30-year-old, but I don't even think I like that. And then all of them, they had to get circumcised that came out of that came out of Egypt and crossed the Red Sea, they had to get circumcised as adults. I'm sure they wasn't happy with that either. But that was, look, that was for them. Now, Yahshua fulfilled that law. He did all of those physical things that needed to be accomplished and ushered in that new covenant. And when he poured out his Holy Spirit, that spirit of righteousness, he did that first to the Jews, which I think rightfully so, even what I think don't matter, but they were the ones that were given that law. So they were the nearest to having some relationship with what was going on with the Messiah as he went through his ministry. So Yahshua was going to take off the flesh, and it's not time for the universal revelation yet, where he appears in the hearts and the minds of every man in a universal manner where all men know him from the greatest to the least. So somebody had to preach that gospel. Somebody had to be an apostle and get out there and preach what Yahshua had done and spread that good news. And that's what we have here at this school, is the ministers who take their time to share what they've come to know. And we don't want to know about what somebody thinks. We want to know about what you know. We want you to be able to prove these things that you're saying according to the scriptures. We don't want to hear about your dog or your cat and how it made you feel or anything like that. That's what I'm saying. But we got a new covenant. And that new covenant is written in our hearts and our minds. And we are not saved through water baptism. We are saved through the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Yahshua said in, I think, John the 12th chapter, or he said, I get it wrong. He said, take on my yoke and learn of me. All thee that are heavy laden and burdened, take on my yoke and learn of me. And as we get inundated in this teaching and in learning of him, then we can know for an assurity, what Yahshua did was in fulfillment of that law. But in order to do that, you need to learn about that law and what that law was. I've been recently listening to one of the transcripts or audio recordings from Dr. Kinney in 1973. Called the Ever Presence of Yahweh. And in that recording, he makes mention of the tabernacle, that pattern of that tabernacle, and our physical bodies. And he says that we need to know something. We need to know about the makeup of our physical bodies. And we need to know the makeup of our Heavenly Father, who's a spiritual body. And once we get familiar with the makeup of our physical body and the spiritual makeup that of Yahweh Elohim, then we can begin to make those correlations and see how they work. with each other, together. There's, and you can see that there's no separation when you have that understanding. So having an understanding of this pattern is one of the most important keys to being able to know something about our Heavenly Father. There's a lot that I want to talk about, and I could just keep going. I could talk about how in that transcript, in that lecture, Dr. Kinley talks about your body and what happens to it when you die and they cremate you. And he talks about that you can put that body in that oven and turn that fire up as hot as you want to turn it up to. And that fire will start consuming that body. And it'll consume all the way down to its, there's nothing there but bones. But it will not consume those bones. And those bones represent that spirit. And what the crematorium has to do when they get done burning up that body, they got to take some sort of machine or a roller or whatnot and crush up those bones. And then that's what they put inside the urn. And usually what you getting back is Aunt May's bones crushed up in the powder. Those aren't ashes. Those are bones. And he talks about how that same body, if you take that body and you put it out into a field and just let it lay out there, that matter that makes up that physical body will absorb into the earth, and it'll make everything, it'll fertilize that ground where that body's at, and everything where that body's at will grow taller than all the way all around it. Acts as a fertilizer. Goes back to the earth. Them bones still remain. And to be able to see those correlations between the physical, you have to see, you see that correlation and you see there's something, it points to there being something spiritual. I don't know if I relayed that. To my best ability. So I just wanted to give a testimony. I wanted to share how important it is to keep asking those questions and don't just ask questions, and when you get the answer, you got to apply the answer to what you're asking the question. I know a long time in my life, I would ask questions and I might get the answer and I don't apply it to what I was asking about. So then until I'm paying attention to that answer that was provided to me, it doesn't make any difference to me. A lot of times you will hear Doc say, stop shuffling around and looking down at the stuff around you in your seat and pay close attention to what's being said. Take apart the words, like really try to have an intimate relationship with the words that are being spoke when somebody's teaching. and make sure that you understand that. And if you don't understand it, then ask the question. We not no yes men around here like they want you to be in Christendom. I didn't get along very well because when I had questions, they didn't want to answer. They didn't want me to ask questions. They just wanted me to be patient. That's how they would tell me, be patient. That was my way. That was their way of telling me to stop asking questions. Be patient and pray and God will show you what you're looking for. That's how they, that is a passive aggressive way getting somebody off your back. Because what you gonna say to that? Okay, be patient. Yeah. In other words, you ain't got the answer. These ministers, most of them will take the shirt off their back for you if they see that you need it. And if you have a question about something and you really want the answer, they will take that time to expound or elaborate on what they know to try to help you to understand. Because that's what is the most important thing for each and every individual. This is a personal thing that we are experiencing here in this school. This ain't a group, a VFW, a social club. And if it was a social club, we're not doing very good because we ain't getting too many of us together in one place all the time. And it's truly pleasurable when we can all get together in conferences or symposiums or seminars, whatever you want, however you want to label and title it. But this is a personal thing, and it's not what the group thinks about. I remember when I first came into this class, I used to hear of the glory days, the so-called glory days of IDMR, where you could get in your car or on a plane or a train and travel to any class in the United States or that was just affiliated with this organization, and the exact same thing would be being preached all the time, and there was never any difference. And that is good, that the saying that the truth would be being preached. I'm not saying that in any way or insinuating in any kind of way that that's not a good thing. What I'm recognizing is that as these righteous principles of Yahweh are being drawn out more and more, and these bodies are getting a more profound understanding of the purpose of Yahweh, that mystery of iniquity is raising up at the same time. And he's working just as hard as Yahweh will allow him to oppose that truth and to keep you pining over those days where you focused on the days where you could go to any class and they preaching the same thing instead of just focusing on what is that true and good and righteous information for you now. Now your focus has got off of the ever presence of Yahweh, and you thinking about the infiltration of erroneous doctrine. We don't want to get tripped up. We don't have time for that. Another thing that Dr. Kinley said in this lecture, talking about the ever presence of Yahweh is that a lot of us do not recognize that we are in the judgment right now. Now, in Him, in Yahweh, we live and move and have our being. And we need to remain conscious of that to the best of our abilities. And I'm personally, in my testimony, this calendar year has offered up a lot of obstacles. And it's caused me at times to focus on solving those problems. And what I've done in many instances, initially, my knee-jerk reaction is to handle it in a carnal, more physical way. But we're in a spiritual age now, and I got to stop looking at things. I'm talking about me now. I got to stop looking at things physically and look at it spiritually. And once I take a look at it according to what level of intelligence is applied to the situation, what kind of wisdom that I have available to apply to the situation, what knowledge of how to not navigate that situation I have, am I hating this thing because I don't want to deal with it? Well, that ain't right. We need to fix that and let go of that hate, that any kind of malice, any kind of jealousy of somebody else who doesn't have to go through that thing. Because all of that is just taken away from energy that I could be spending on solving that could be spent on solving the problem. We got two mysteries in operation. You got the mystery of righteousness and you got a mystery of iniquity. And they're both operating according to the pattern. And if you can can we get that chart up? Do we have that chart to bring up the Aya Asha Aya chart? Yeah. So they all are operating according to principles. And that mystery of righteousness is operating according to righteousness, peace, and joy, and truth, and everything that the mystery of righteousness will produce will bear good fruit. You see those trees down there at the foundation or the feet of Yahweh Elohim represented there, green, and the grass is green around it too. We in California in a severe drought right now, so we can't even see too many trees like that. You got water bill if you got trees like that in your yard. You got real water bill. But that mystery of righteousness bears fruit. Now you go over on the other side, you got that mystery of iniquity. And you've got Jannies and Jambres down there playing tricks, parlor tricks, magicians. And they're serving the man who is Pharaoh. Their job is to serve the man. Over on the left-hand side, you got Yahweh's only begotten son, Yahshua the Messiah, and he serves his father. He's doing the work of, he's doing his father's business. That's what he said. He, you go around, he's doing everything that he did was his father's business. Now you got down here, you got that mystery of iniquity. You got Jannes and Jambres down there, and they were servants to Pharaoh, and they were there to stroke his ego and do his bidding. Everything that Pharaoh told them to do, their job was to figure out how to get it done. And it didn't matter if they had to go into the jailhouse and find somebody who knew how to do it better than them and threaten their lives or the lives of their families to get it done. Their job was to make sure that that man, Pharaoh, was satisfied serving that man. And you read over in Revelations about wisdom and that 666 being the number of a man, and understanding that six lies on that pattern is that second compartmental veil that you have once you've gone and made it into the holy place, the veil that separates all that is in the holy place, or that second compartment. It separates all of that seven branch candlestick, table of shewbread, and altar of incense, that golden altar of incense in the holy place. There's a second veil, and that veil isn't opened at all. That high priest, only way that he can get into the most holy place is the little one cubit opening on the right and the left side. Inside of that holy place, you had to go up on that. You go in on the right side and come out on the left side when he did his officiation. And it was a small opening, and that curtain stayed closed. The only reason why it's open here on this chart right now is so that you can see what the structure of the tabernacle in comparison with the structure of your physical body, so that one can make that correlation in the operation of the two. There's a what's the scripture? It says, "Know ye not that your body is the temple?" Let me see. Okay, give me 1 Corinthians 6:19. Well, we got this chart up. All right. Your body, you don't have a body. This is another thing. I mean, I got so much out of this lecture. Dr. Kinley said it, and it makes sense, and you can prove it according to the scriptures, what we reading right here. He said, you don't have a body. This isn't your body. Your physical body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. You get some fool come up behind you and want to say everybody got the Holy Spirit. because it says, what know ye not? That in the Bible, what know ye not that your body is temple of the Holy Spirit? But if you don't know nothing, see, Yahweh's out running the whole show. But if you don't know nothing about that, your body is the temple of Yahweh, then that ain't the Holy Spirit in operation. That's the mystery of iniquity. You know. Now, this tabernacle is so important because it shows that makeup. And that tabernacle that was given out in the wilderness, that was a kingdom for them. And I appreciate, I know the previous speaker may mention the Springfield's class today. I didn't get to make it to see that one, but I was present on Tuesday, and Dr. Frank Lewis, he defined kingdom. And he said, kingdom, it means, stands for king's dominion. That law that was given to those Jews that they were to follow as they walked and followed that tabernacle around, that was the king's dominion for them with physical things. Once that new law, that new covenant, which is written in your heart and mind, it was put into place, it took that physical law out of the way and made it unnecessary to do. We don't want to erase it from the history books because we can use it to show, to know, to prove in detail how it, all of those physical things represent the spiritual counterpart with that points back those principles, the principle of all of those things, that the structure and function of that tabernacle, it points to the spirit from which all of that, these physical things emanate from. And when you can take a conversation, you know, being an introduction, a subject, and then a conclusion, and you can see clearly that that's threefold and that's not a physical thing. That's speech. It's incorporeal in a sense till you write it down on paper, but it's fluid. But that conversation is made according to that pattern. Yahweh put his name on everything. He put his pattern on everything. When he created Yahweh Elohim, he went out of the creating business. Yahweh in pure spirit did. And he gave that. And let me say it this way, everything that was created in this creation was created by that pattern of Yahweh Elohim. The first thing Yahweh commanded Yahweh Elohim to do was be fruitful and multiply. And we are still experiencing that to this day. Astroscientists are coming back with reports of new discoveries in the universe, and will swear up and down and tell you and show evidence that the universe is still expanding as we speak right now. It's ever expanding, which represents Yahweh Elohim following that commandment, that son following that commandment of being fruitful and multiplying. I'm going to leave the last half hour for another person to speak. I just want to say that if you don't understand the structure and function of this tabernacle and how it correlates to your physical body and how it correlates to the principles of Yahweh, our Elohim, ask a question. Ask your dean, ask one of your brethren, and don't stop there. and ask until you know. Pick up the book, investigate, study these charts, because you're going to need this in order to know for an assurity that what's being taught down here is real. I hope and trust that something was got out of what I was saying. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Hortense and Dr. Hudgenwaterl. Is there anyone else? Okay, Dr. Wunsch. Our next speaker will be Dr. Bud Wunsch.
Now, this is an observation from Dr. Dennis Droulard that he shared with me, and he's been gone for 20 years. But he said, how many people think time is going faster now? No comments? I'm getting some nods. I think it's going much faster than it used to. And Dr. Droulard's explanation of that is we are no longer expanding. We are now contracting. And as it's coming back, when you make things smaller, it goes faster and faster and faster. The smaller it gets, the faster it goes, the smaller it gets. So what used to take an actual hour now might be like 10 or 15 minutes because we are contracting, not expanding. Something to think about. That's it.
Thank you, Dr. Wunsch. Our next speaker for this evening will be the Dean of Ontario, Dr. Marlon Love.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
And I also am appreciative of having the opportunity to once again come and share a little bit of what I know about this great universal and divine gospel that we've been bequeathed by way of Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, who he himself also received the vision. This work that we see around us on these charts are indicative of what he saw and was given in a vision that we've come to want to learn something about Yahweh as he really is and actually exists. And we endeavor to scrutinize the Bible, scrutinize these charts, which are no different than pictorial illustrations that are within your Bible. We have a textbook, a four-volume textbook by which the founder put together with a group of other people as well, and comprised of a textbook that we have that goes into a migratory, it goes into many things, multiple things that one can learn and study upon and grasp a little information about where they're at. I'm going to cut break real quick. Sean, can you stop sharing on the screen share so we can maybe get the Zoom back correctly? I think there's a hindrance there. So if you can do that for a minute and then that can
be. Yeah, I was working on it, but I never did start trying to share.
There's an ugly car.
Yeah, you got to get off the line for some reason, I guess.
Yeah, I'm working on it.
Are you going to get off the line, if you would, please?
Okay.
And so, as the previous speaker said and was elaborating on, we come and some of us been here 50 years, some of us for a long time, some of us for a short time. And inevitably, all the time that we come, there's something that we pick up and learn from, which is part of life, learning every day. You know, I know school, and we take Romans 1:19 and 20, we look at the educational system just as school is. There's an end date of that learning called graduation, essentially, right? You know, you got elementary, graduate to junior high to high school, and high school to college. And then after college, you might have a graduate doctorate type of deal. But there's a graduation after that. But then ultimately, you got life. School of life, school of hard knocks, or whatever you want to call it. Mm-hmm. And that don't ever end until your last breath, right? And so these are the things that we want to be able to learn before we take off the flesh. Because one thing Dr. McKinley said, because everybody likes to quote Dr. McKinley, he said that one thing that we don't know is how we're going to be able to learn without a physical body. Now, we're in a spiritual kingdom age, being that this fourth age is the present kingdom age. And as Sean expressed, that the kingdom is a king's domicile or control. And we're to be controlled by the Holy Spirit and not by the flesh.
Right.
That's what Sean was laboring about, that we try to or ought to begin to look at this migratory pattern as a spiritual pattern and not just a physical one, as far as trying to emulate any of these past patriarchs, if you would. And for the most part, we know that we can't perform these 613 judgments, statutes, and ordinances. We know that, but yet something, as John was trying to express, has to go. Something within us that's controlling us, and we can label it the mystery of iniquity, as Sean expressed, that there's two mysteries in operation, one of righteousness and one of unrighteousness, and that we have been bred into this unrighteousness when we came out of our mother's womb. Well, it's no different than the children of Israel were down here in Egypt. Remember, we had Psalms 150 read today. It was a long chapter. But that chapter expressed everything from Abraham and his patronages. Remember, you got generations. His patronages just died off that came down here into Egypt. Because remember, Joseph was sold down here into Egypt. And after a point in time, that Pharaoh died. And those that came down, those 70, which was the patronage, because it started off a small group, remember? That group passed away under that first Pharaoh that made Joseph second in command. Now you have a new nation of people down in Egypt that's been born in under iniquity, if you would. So we're looking at the Passover, or the children of Israel down here, and we read it in Psalms, which is a quick excerpt about this migratory pattern, of how they come up out of this pattern.
Right.
And that generation was born in darkness, is what I'm expressing. Just like I just made the statement that we're born in darkness too, under this Luciferic nature. You follow? And now we have to come up out of this darkness. Now we're using this migratory pattern, this Moses pattern, as a witness that Yahweh promised Abraham. promised him that his seed's going to return to this land. You follow?
Yeah.
Now, that's what that was accomplished. If you read Psalms 105, you read on over to 106, it's going to take you up into this nation and tell you about what they did and how they conducted themselves and how they whored themselves out under other nations.
Okay.
As they were told not to. Okay. You follow? Mm-hmm. Now, we're going to come up out of this darkness state of ignorance because, hey, we've learned a name. That name that was given to unto Moses. That's why we're of Abraham's seed according to the Spirit. And this is where we need to get back to.
Right.
And we're using this as a pattern of heavenly things. That's what this tabernacle was that Moses saw in a vision in his consciousness. You follow? And we needed to be able to see this pattern in its righteousness. Because it's going to do us good because we're offsprings of this one.
Right.
Genesis 1 and 26. Then I'm going to like to have a few.
Can somebody turn off that main monitor and then turn it back on again? Because it got disconnected from the computer somehow. It's not being read.
Thank you, Sean. Say 126. You can be around 125 okay. when you're ready.
125?
Yeah.
Genesis 125. And Elohim made the beasts of the earth after their kind.
Now we're talking about the fifth day when he made the beasts of this earth. Okay?
And the cattle after their kind.
Mm-hmm.
And everything that creepeth upon the ground after their kind.
Now we know also, we said it on Tuesday's class, and we're reading now. This first chapter is according to Moses' vision, okay? Not how the creation was created in solar days, mm-hmm. but according to Moses' vision, he's talking about this beast of the land, sea, and the air. Keep reading.
And Elohim saw that it was good.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness."
Now he's going to make man in our image, as speaking as Elohim, in our image and our likeness.
Mm-hmm.
That's plural, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Elohim, we say, is a pluralistic title, right? This pluralistic title is a title that Yahweh gave himself.
Right.
You follow? Now, we need to understand this title, just as we need to understand this migratory pattern, because it takes our picture. We're coming full circle. We've come from out of pure spirit,
mm-hmm.
typified by that cerebral fluid, where that spermiac fluid is created in our consciousness mm-hmm. that comes down into the man's testicles,
right.
and then ultimately is exodus into the woman's fallopian tubes. You get me?
Right.
So the same thing that is coming out of this this pure spirit state, and it's going to come down, and then it's going to return back.
Right.
You follow? Now he's going to create himself Elohims. You follow?
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Mm-hmm. And Elohim saw that it was good.
Now Elohim, the Yahweh Elohim, the Elohims of the Elohims. You have Eloah, expressed as in a singular form as well. I forget where Eloah is. You recall where that's at? Eloah, I think it was Daniel somewhere. We don't need to get that so much right now. But we're dealing with an understanding about who we are, about why we want to get back and know for surety how this migratory works. Because Sean expressed it, Hartense expressed it. She's been here for a number of years, and she, I don't know, hadn't seen this dark portion or didn't see that this cloud also included that portion. Maybe it wasn't a thick enough cloud shape here. I don't know. But yet, we see it up here, but when you get down here, you think it's all black, but that cloud is also running down and around this dark area. Because Yahweh is all in all. We make statements. We've read other things, and we've been here. We don't want to be here a long time and not see the certain things that we're expressing and what we're talking about. So therefore, like Sean said, we got to ask questions in order to make things clear and understand. Now, he said, go back to Genesis
26.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim said, let us make man in our image,
now you got
after our likeness.
Now you got a plural thing going on here. Read.
And let them rule over the fish of the sea.
Now those that we create are going to rule over that which he created in the fifth day. Read.
And over the birds of the heaven, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth.
Mm-hmm.
So Elohim created man in his image. In the image of Elohim created he him. Male and female created he him.
Created he him. Both male and female is created as he him. Right? We have this man, this chart, man made in the image of Elohim by the pattern of the tabernacle. We know that Elohim is the tabernacle or temple, right? And we're created in that same likeness. But there's many of us. Mm-hmm. That's the pluralistic nature. You're an Elohim. You're an Elohim. You're an Elohim. You're an Elohim. You're an Elohim, right? But then we're not an Elohim that understands this mystery. And this is what we're learning and coming into. Because, hey, after all, John 1 and 4, right quick. Every man, Dr. Kinley said, everybody like to say Dr. Kinley said, that every man has a sufficient amount of intelligence in them in order to know of Yahweh. Read John 1 and 4. And he's not saying, again, Dr. Kennedy's not saying it because he's saying it. Right. He's saying it because he's read it in the book.
Mm-hmm.
Read it.
John 1 and 4.
Uh-huh.
In him was life.
In him was life. In and him, Elohim, the Elohim. We're an offspring. I can point to this chart here, eternity. This Elohim or this individual or angel or angelic being in this circle is indicative of this Elohim. Comprende? Down through the purpose, pattern, and plan of Yahweh, you have multiple Elohims now. Angels or Elohims from off of this one, because he's going forth and multiply. When his seed or his offspring is going to be like him. Like everybody want to be like Mike. They want to get the basketball shoes. They get on the team. They want number jersey 23. Or this is the way they used to. Right. They want the same jersey. They want the same haircut. They put the line. They want to emulate. They put the band on the arm. They want to emulate that which they admire.
Mm-hmm.
But we're coming to see and know Yahweh as he really is and exists in us.
Right.
You follow? This is what we're striving. This is what all of this is made up for. Okay? Keep reading.
And the life was the light of men.
Uh-huh.
Go back to Jesus.
Now, that's the light of men. Isaiah 8 and 20. This is how we're going to know about what we're talking about. Moses wrote the first five books, I think Sean said, and then the subsequent 34 books from Joshua to Malachi. They're not just fables and some random stories about some random people. They're about Yahshua the Messiah, right. Our Father. You follow? Our Maker. And how to put, now we may not understand how it works and put together. That's under our iniquitous state and condition. Mm-hmm. That's why you have to seek Yahweh. As he, yes, someone told me, expressed today, that it's unmerited favor. We have an unmerited favor or a gift, a free gift. And that it is. But you have to reach forth and take it and know it and work with it.
Right.
Because faith without works, I think is expressed there in Hebrews or wherever there in the epistles, faith without works doesn't do you a bit of good either. What's the works? Is that being a secretary, being an accountant, being a dean, being something? That's not the works. That's all physical. That's all physical. What work are you going to do? You're going to baptize? We already got us getting off of these carnal ordinances. Right. So what work are you going to bring in and substitute it? You're going to say, oh, I'm going to vacuum the room. I'm going to give more donation. I'm not going to call it a tithe, but I'm going to just give donation. What work is it going to work?
That's right.
What? And if it's physical, it's no more different than a carnal ordinance.
That's right.
Unless someone come and prove me wrong, it's a carnal, it's a work.
That's right.
Now, if you don't know what a work is, then that's something that needs to be questioned and understand. Just like the question about how are there many Elohims and who are the other Elohims? This is what we're reading and about to find out. And it's going according to this migratory pattern. Because, hey, as it was expressed in Psalms, that this nation of people were going to be the sons of Elohim. Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
Did you want me to get Isaiah 8 and 20?
Yes, please.
To the law and mm-hmm. to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
There's no light or understanding. Now, as John said, he's the life that lighteth every man. But you have to have the light of the law and the prophets or the testimony in you in order to have any wisdom or knowledge or light. You got to know. I think Sean, he quoted the scripture or quoted the verse about Yahshua needing to learn of Yahshua.
Oh, yeah, Matthew.
Yeah. What was it?
Matthew 11.
And 28. Yeah. 24, somewhere like that. Matthew 11 and 24. He said, Yahshua say, learn of me, for my burden is light. Right? You have it, Eunice? I don't think we had it read.
Yeah. Matthew 11:28.
Okay, follow now. He said, John 1:1 said that the word was Yahweh, was with Yahweh. And he said that this word was the light that lighteth every man. That's the free gift. That's what everyone has, without a doubt.
Right.
But you got to come a certain way.
That's right.
With what you got in you. And like Sean said, as things get trickier, get harder, people are going to start crying out. Because the way they used to be able to do things just don't work no more.
That's right.
And that's going to be a problem to a lot of people when you just can't fill up when you want to fill up. You just can't go or fly where you want to fly because of the car. You're going to have problems and you're going to want to know why. But until then, as Sean said, everyone want to have their own free spirit. If you would, and do things how they want to do things. Mm-hmm. But see, Yahshua the Messiah said he's the way, the life, and the truth. You follow? Mm-hmm. And again, he said that under the law. He said that under the law. You read it in the so-called New Testament, but that Yahshua the Messiah said that under the law. And he's speaking according to this migratory pattern, if you would. Mm-hmm. Because, hey, he doesn't get off of this pattern, huh? born under the law, raised up under the law, and died under the law.
So he's not coming up off of that until the outpouring of the Holy Spirit enters into the hearts and minds of men, where they have a capacity to learn about Yahshua the Messiah, because it was finished. Mm-hmm. The work that he set up to do.
Right.
And now, if you're going to be able to learn about the work he set up to do, you're going to need to know what Isaiah talked about the law and the prophets, or testimony, mm-hmm. about that, which is going to be the light, mm-hmm. that lighteth every man. Because that's what's going to be able to draw your soul from out of the ignorance or the darkness by which we were born in. Piecemeal. And it's going to come fast and furious if you don't have a class like this. Does that Sean Express? You have a Zoom like Hartens was able to listen across the country in order to get a little revelation about how this cloud actually goes all the way around. And this is like an into the spirit. Mm-hmm. Acts the 17th chapter talks about Acts the 17:24, I think.
Acts 17:24.
Being in the spirit, I want to. No, we live, move, and have our being. 28. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
For in him we live and we move and have our beings. As some of your own voice.
We live, move. That's what this cloud represents on this chart.
Right.
We live, move, and have our being right within this spirit. Mm-hmm. Here, symbolized as a cloud. Mm-hmm. There's no difference. You follow? Mm-hmm. So.
For we are also his offspring.
Now, we're his offspring. That's Elohim. Mm-hmm. Offspring of. Now, go grab me Psalms 82 and start at 1. And go ahead and start when you get it, please.
Okay. 82:1. Mm-hmm. Elohim standeth in the congregation of the mighty.
Now Elohim is standing in the congregation of the mighty. Read.
He judgeth among the strong.
He's judging among the strong. Sean expressed that we're being judged now in this sixth day, in this sixth hour. How can we be judged? Mm-hmm. We're not thinking that we're gonna go to no plural gates, do we? We don't think we're gonna get up there and talk to Peter and John up there at the plural gates and state our case about who did what to us. We're not looking at it according to that. Can't be at this time. We have too much information not to be in that ignorant state of condition.
Right.
You follow? So let's go ahead and read about Elohim, about some judgment going on. Read.
How long will ye judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked?
Mm-hmm.
How long? Defend the poor and fatherless. Do justice to the afflicted and needy.
Mm-hmm.
Deliver the poor and needy. Rid them out of the hand of the wicked.
Mm-hmm.
They know not, neither will they understand. They walk on in darkness. All the fountains of the earth are out of course.
Mm-hmm. You have to think things are out of course. Getting hot in some areas. Snowed in Africa the other day. Ain't never snowed there in a certain region over there in Africa. Huh. Out of course. You got
Colorado River.
The atmosphere with
the climate change
and all of that. Out of sorts. Yeah. Keep reading.
I have said, ye are Elohim.
Now, I have said, ye are Elohim. Read. Mm-hmm.
For all of you are children of the Most High.
For all of us are children of the Most High. And he called them Elohim. You follow? Because mm-hmm. why? We're made in the image and likeness of men. You follow? And he said, you're judging. Mm-hmm. He's going to judge. And we should have righteous judgment. We should know that we're not going to no pearly gates and talking to Peter and John to let us in nowhere. We ought to know about these things. About he wasn't he's no longer on this cross. You follow? We should know we're not being baptized. Certain things we know, but then there are certain things we're not fully aware of. How can Elohim be a son? Why is it not Yahshua? Why is Yahshua the Holy Spirit? You know what I'm saying? That Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua is sometimes confusing. People are not comprehending now. Yahweh, comprehending. I said, comprende. I use a little spoken Spanish. Nevertheless, this Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua, we say is one name. But we have a problem because how is this the son? Because you barely read Elohim in the so-called New Testament of the Bible. And then therefore, where did Elohim go to?
Yeah.
Well, why is that? And now all of a sudden it's Yahshua. Mm-hmm. But you say Yahshua is the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, these are little things that are confounding and confusing.
Yeah.
Hey, we have a migratory pattern. It takes your picture. How does it take our picture? We say it. And like Sean expressed, we need to know how this is operating because we're responsible. We've been invited. Huh? Freely.
Right.
A gift. We don't pay.
That's true.
We're not required of anything other than to pay attention, which is a reasonable service to do.
Mm-hmm.
For what? To gain what? And to overcome what? Hey, he had to come overcome death.
Yeah.
And we're made in his likeness and image of him. So we're having to go through and fulfill something.
Mm-hmm.
There's things that we're atoning for. There's things that we're getting cleaned up by based off the gospel of how we used to act
right. And
how we're not acting anymore. That's why you have a new offspring that crossed over the River Jordan. All those that came up from out of Egypt all died in the wilderness, save three.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Which is typified of the unity of the oneness of Yahweh. So you got to look at it according to a principle. Not all these people came across the Jordan River.
Right.
So therefore, you got to look at it psychologically and spiritually so that you can't act and be like that in this wilderness state. You're going to have to cross that veil, that sixth veil. Sean talked about it a little bit on that tabernacle pattern. And you're going to have to eat that, accept that, and you're going to put your foot in that. With what? With the law and the prophets. Because everything else, Yahweh had already got it taken care of. Our responsibility is to learn of him.
Right.
That's what's going to make it light and make it worthwhile.
Mm-hmm.
For our souls, to be at rest in Canaan's land. We read it in the Psalms that he finished it. He fulfilled that. And he was able to make it whole and make it complete.
Hmm.
Right? Now, I would like to get... Yeah, that's going to be John 10:34.
Yep.
I'm going to need also... Yeah, go ahead and get John 10:24.
10:34. Or you want me to start up at 24?
Which 24?
Then came the Jews round about him and said unto him, how long?
Yeah, go ahead and catch that right there. Read down and let me know when you get to 34.
Okay.
Just read down. Now pay attention. People want to say, you know, I'm still sinning. And I'm a sinner and I got to wait till I die before I get cleaned up. And that's another one of those false understandings.
Mm-hmm.
That's an ignorant statement. But what are you going to say to a person, express to a person that you're not in that state and condition no more.
Right.
See,
okay.
That's the work.
Yeah.
That's the work.
Okay.
I said earlier, what is the work? Now I'm coming around full circle as someone who's in this state and condition, because it talks about it in Jude, being able to pull out your brother out of the fire of ignorance,
mm-hmm.
of lack of understanding, being scorched by the feet by the burden of the flame of Yahweh and the conditions that people are going to be in.
Right.
And it's going to be the work to preach the gospel to their souls in order for them to what? Walk in the way, the truth, and the life of Yahshua the Messiah. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, read.
And Yahshua walked in the temple in Solomon's porch.
Uh-huh.
Then came the Jews round about him and said unto him, how long dost thou make us to doubt? If thou be the Messiah, tell us plainly. Yahshua answered them, I told you, and ye believe not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But ye believe not, because ye are not of my sheep, as I said unto you. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me.
See, that's the Elohims. Those sheep are Elohims that are following Elohim, or Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? Read.
And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand.
See, once you end that bond, and you have that light and understanding within you, and it begins to shine, and you're sealed, not backsliding. You've gone all the way in and up. That's another thing Dr. Kennedy used to say. There's no such thing as a backslider. Right. You know, they just hadn't slid in far enough.
Right.
You want to say Dr. Kennedy said. That's but nonetheless, hey, you got to go all the way in. And when you get all the way in, you'll never lose the grip of Yahshua Messiah. Read.
I and my Father are in accord.
Uh-huh.
Then the Jews took up stones again to stone
him. Now, they don't like that statement. Mm-hmm. And they're about to stone them. Mm-hmm. In their physical conditions, they're going to
eradicate the flesh. Because that's all that they're looking at. And that's what Sean expressed. We can't be dealing with throwing stones at people every time they piss you off. Every time you have a condition or a situation and you want to take up stones with words or sticks, it doesn't make no difference. You want to hurt a person. Because what? You're ignorant and not knowing how to bring them up out of the darkness.
Yep.
The problem is a good problem. Because Dr. Kennedy said,
that's right.
Dr. Kennedy said that Satan and Lucifer is
an
him.
Yep. He's an asset.
To you.
Mm-hmm.
So you're back in the, you're doomed.
That's right.
Damned if you do, damned if you don't. And the only thing you can do is come
up off yourself and learn about Yahshua.
That's right.
Because his burden
is light. He's telling you it's light. Just learn of him because everything is already worked out. It was worked out from the foundation of the world.
Yes, it was.
It's what we're expressing. You follow? And you're talking about Elohims and who you are. Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
Yahshua answered them,
uh-huh.
Many good works have I showed you from my Father, for which of those works do ye stone me?
Right.
The Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy, and because that thou, being a man, makest thyself Elohim.
Now, he being a
man, that's what I'm saying. We're all men. Remember, Adam and Eve was one. Mm-hmm. Made them him.
Mm-hmm.
Right? However, when in Genesis, we had it read earlier,
yeah.
That he made the man and the woman and called he them, mm-hmm. or him,
mm-hmm.
man, right. Made in the image and likeness of Elohim, mm-hmm. who is spirit, him. The moderation said, this spirit came down into a form of a body. And now they're calling Yahshua right now a man. Mm-hmm. They don't see that he is spirit.
Right.
We are spirit. Sean said, Sean recited what he read or heard that Dr. Kennedy said, that our vessels, or this body, is a vessel. Mm-hmm. It's a temple. Mm-hmm. It's a dwelling place
right.
for the Holy Spirit, mm-hmm. or the soul in the man.
Yeah.
You follow? Now they're looking at the body. They were trying to stone Yahshua. Mm-hmm. Read.
Yahshua answered them, is it not written in your law, I said, ye are Elohim? If he called them Elohim, unto whom the word of Yahweh came, and the scriptures cannot be broken.
Oh, the scriptures cannot be broken. Mm-hmm. And he's telling them that didn't your law or the scriptures
That's
say
right.
Ye are Elohims. And we had it read in Psalms, right?
Right.
That ye are Elohims. Mm-hmm. And he said, we had it read in Genesis, that ye are Elohim, made in the likeness and image.
Right.
After our kind. Mm-hmm. It's pluralistic. It's more than, it's a pluralistic title, mm-hmm. Elohim. And that's what we're supposed to be. You follow? Keep reading a little bit.
Say ye of him whom the Father has sanctified and sent into the world, thou blasphemous, because I said, I am the son of Elohim. If I do not the works of my Father, believe me not. But if I do, thou ye believe not me. Believe the works that ye may know, and believe that the Father is in me, and I in him.
Now that's what Yahshua said, that he is in him. This is what we're needing to understand about this migratory pattern. Because Yahshua was down here with Moses. He's the one that was down here with the children of Israel before they even crossed the Red Sea. He was down here for some 30, he was 30 years old when he appeared down here. Mm-hmm. He's here. These are the things we need to know according to a spiritual and psychological principle of the matter. And it will be our stability of the time. Now, right quick, time is of the essence. Grab me 1 Corinthians 6 and 1.
1 Corinthians.
And we're talking about problems. We're talking about situations as well. And we're talking about knowing something about Yahshua Messiah. In order to do what and for what?
1 Corinthians 6 and 1.
Uh-huh.
Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unjust and not before the sons?
Oh, before the sons. Don't go before the sons, who are Elohims, the real offsprings of Yahweh. Mm-hmm. You follow? And you're going to go to a law before you come to us.
Right.
It's what it's expressing. Saul's expressing. But those are people that know the law and know who are sons. You follow? In order to do what?
Do ye not know that the sons shall judge the world? And if the world shall be judged by you.
Was that pluralistic? That's going to be judging the world?
The sons.
Read.
And if the world shall be judged by you, are ye unworthy to judge the smallest matters?
Mm-hmm.
Know ye not that we shall judge angels? How much more the things that pertain to this life?
Mm-hmm.
If then ye have judgments of things pertaining to this life, do ye set them to judge who are least esteemed in the assembly? I speak to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you? No, not one that shall be able to judge between his brethren. But brother goeth to law with brother, mm-hmm. and that before the unbeliever.
Mm-hmm. Now, you don't do that in front of people that don't know and don't understand, because we have a job to do in contending with one another about physical matters is a mute point. And understanding what it's really about, mm-hmm. is about understanding Yahshua Messiah. Mm-hmm. Now skip over to Jude right quick. You get the point. You read the rest of that yourself. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and skip over and I'll be done. And start at 1 and 20. Starting 119. Start at 118, and we'll be and run on all the way down. We'll be done. What's my time on there? Running out.
119.
Yes, 119.
Jude, these be they who separate themselves, since for having not the Spirit.
Now, those are not having the Spirit. Those who are not of Elohim, of that court. Of those unjust,
right. Oh, okay.
That don't know, that don't understand this information, that we're sharing and preaching to the whole world. You follow? Read.
But ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit.
You're building ourselves up and learning about Yahshua the Messiah in the Holy Spirit. Not according to the physical manifestation of things, but according to spiritual principles by which we're reading in order to build our understanding about the faith And again, we know the faith of Hebrews 11 chapter, talking about that faith is a substance, is a thing. Mm-hmm. These are substances, these are attributes that can be seen and touched and handled according to the principles by which they demonstrate. Physically, of course, but then the wisdom of understanding how they actually came into being, into form, and transmuting and changing. That's what you say, that's the power of Yahweh. That's what makes this Elohim supreme over all Elohims. That's why we're subject unto this one. You follow? Keep reading, please.
Keep yourselves in the love of Yahweh.
Yes.
Looking for the mercy of our Savior, Yahshua, the Messiah,
yes,
of the eternal life. Some refuse while they dispute with you.
See, some are going to dispute with you. They're going to contend with you. But you can't pick up stones and beat them. You can't pick up stones and act like them.
That's true.
Can't be a That's child in this that we've been given. And it's something we're supposed to be able to have changed. Just like they
right.
children of Israel have changed. And it was a new offspring that right. came over into this promised land.
That's right.
Read.
But others save by arousing their fear, pulling them out of the fire.
You know what I'm saying?
Every trace of sinfulness.
Listen, read. Go back and reread that. That's what I wanted.
But others save by arousing their fear, pulling them out of the fire.
Pulling them out of the fire. How are you going to pull someone out of the fire? Are you going to be reaching in hot flames and fire? You're going to put a fireman's jacket on? We all got to go get certified to be a firefighter? What fire are you talking about? And how are you going to pull somebody out? That's the question. You're going to pull them out by the way preaching of the gospel,
right,
of the ignorance, and pull them out of that steep black ignorance
right.
that they know not of. That's the fire that's going to be, they're going to be in ashes because they'll be burning up within themselves because they had the sufficient amount of intelligence to have had already learned about Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? Not waiting until the last hour
right.
called procrastination. I get it. I'm almost a fan of procrastination in my daily life. But anymore, hey, I try to learn all I can about Yahshua the Messiah. Asking brothers about questions I've been asked that I don't know about. I don't know when or how I'm going to need to know it, but hey, it sure be nice to know about 2520, about the four horsemen, because hey, I don't know who's going to come and ask. And if I can reach in down, not reaching physically, but reaching down with my words and my vernacular in the understanding of the faith of Yahshua Messiah in order to stabilize them, to pull them out of the ash of the fire. Sean talked about ashes today,
yeah.
you follow? And the bones there today, and what those bones and souls represent, you follow? Mm-hmm. It's that soul that we're reaching back into that fire. Keep reading.
Hating every trace of sinful lust.
Hating the trace of the ignorance of sinful lust. That's what we become as we learn more perfectly about Yahshua Messiah and that beast man of sin or that unrighteous conscience or that iniquitous state of thinking and understanding. Read.
Now unto him
yes.
that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim.
To the only wise Elohim. We're Elohim, but there is a wise, the only wise Elohim. You follow? That's why we have to be able to speak the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. Not ourselves, not our imaginations, not our concept or opinion. It has to be according to the scriptures. And that's going to be able to lead a man from out of the fire.
Right.
Based off of Yahweh's word, by which you're a son of, and an ambassador of, or an Elohim of, in order to save one soul. Finish it up.
Through Yahshua the Messiah.
Through Yahshua the Messiah, our sovereign, our savior, which is Yahweh. Read.
Belong glory and majesty, dominion and power.
Dominion, the kingdom. That's what Sean talked about, that dominion is the kingdom which we can have and must have now before we take off the flesh or before the universal revelation of Yahshua Messiah. You follow? This is called the present kingdom age in the sixth dispensation. That got to be known now. Read.
Both before all time and now and ever.
Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
This concludes this evening's workshop. Are there any announcements?
announcements?
No.
No.
We hold classes here in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring your enemies and friends. This is the place to learn about our Heavenly Father. Let's all stand and be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time and now and forever. Let us all say, Amen. Hallelujah.